startled that he dropped a glowing cigarette between his legs. It made an ugly mark on the sofa and knocked over a mug full of beer which he had placed on the floor. But he liked the other animals, especially Dick the rabbit and Moby the white guinea pig, and their acquaintance ended in a rather sad way. However, he never ceased to grumble about the names Ern had given them, saying that he couldn't see the humor in giving an innocent guinea pig a whale's name. Besides, Dick was by far the most ridiculous name he had ever heard for a female rabbit. He made no complaints about the cat's name, though, and no doubt thought it was appropriate. The cat name was Ratty. I was on my way home from the supermarket when the accident involving Moby and Dick occurred. We had visited one of the local pubs at lunchtime, our favorite on the main street of the area. Its walls were lined with books, and Howard had gone home before me. He couldn't be bothered to help buying something for supper. In view of what was happening while I was in the shop, it was rather unfortunate that I bought guinea pig food, a bag of dry food enriched with vitamins, on that occasion. I had given Howard the key to the house and had to ring the doorbell several times before he answered. When he finally heard the bell, he came running to the door and with a look of despair in his eyes pushed me towards the back garden. I remember being quite sure that he had broken the flower pot, which he had just missed so often while playing basketball in the garden. I always had the feeling that he made the guinea pig and rabbit nervous by bouncing that ball around. But on this occasion, it was they, that is Moby and Dick, who made life more miserable, strange though it may seem, for Howard. When I reached the back garden, still holding on to the shopping bags, I saw them lying on the dirty, wet paving stones as if they were frozen. They looked all grey and exceedingly pathetic. I remember Howard crouching down in front of the animals and groaning. I don't know how it happened, but by putting two and two together, I could see just as well as he could what had happened. Sorry. I thought that the bag of cement, which Earth admitted he should have gotten rid of long ago, had been closed. And when I asked Howard if he had opened it, he said no and claimed that either Moby or Dick had opened it. Still, one way or another, they had both climbed inside the bag and were nosing about inquisitively in the grey cement when Howard came home and looked out of the window. He said that he had run out into the garden like a shot and grabbed the animals out of the bag. At first, he had tried to brush the cement off them, but when he saw that didn't clean their fur properly, he had pulled out the hose that was lying curled up in the corner by the kitchen door and turned on the tap. He said he hadn't had any doubts as he hosed down the animals that he was doing the right thing. He had tried to reduce the force of the water by narrowing the opening with his thumb, spreading the water over a wider area. When he put the hose down and bent to look at the animals, it didn't take him long, maybe 2 or 3 minutes, to realize that things weren't quite as they should have been. Not that it was a new experience for Howard, his life had probably never had been as it was meant to be. He said he had not timed it, naturally, but he guessed that the cement had only taken about 4 or 5 minutes to harden around the soft fur of the poor animals. It was, however, more difficult to say precisely when they had stopped breathing. I remember the first thought that came into my mind was that they had been walled up alive like the Canterville Ghost. Of course, there was no denying that the accident was tragicomic, and now looking back on it, with Howard here in person in my living room, treating Armand Waller to my purchases from the duty-free store, I thought for the second time today that what doesn't kill a man makes him stronger. Those words are no doubt appropriate in certain circumstances, but it would be necessary to rearrange them so that they made sense in this case. When we sat down to accept what had happened and take stock of the situation, Howard suggested that we buy replacements. It must be possible to find another albino guinea pig and another light brown rabbit in a city as large as London, and it wasn't entirely certain that Osk and Earth would ever see the difference. For some reason, I found the idea rather distasteful. It was horrible to think of Osk coming home and noticing that the rabbit and guinea pig in the garden were not the same animals she had left when she went off on holiday. And Howard and I would pretend that nothing had changed. Is that Moby? Os would ask, really perplexed. And we would coolly say that it was, as if we were rather surprised that she should ask such a question. But Moby had a tear in its ear, she was likely to say next, and we would look as if we didn't understand what she was talking about. The ear had probably healed while she was in Europe. She had been away for a rather long time. Then she would look puzzled and think that Dick was a slightly darker color than she remembered, and the guinea pig looked thinner. Hadn't we given it enough to eat? After discussing these strange changes in the animals, which we naturally weren't aware of, we would sit down and have some tea or coffee, and Osk's suspicions would remain unsolved, something beyond our human understanding, perhaps supernatural. But of course, I had the task of explaining what had happened when Osk came home about 4 weeks later. Howard had been gone for a while by then, and he had added to my worries by causing another accident, if it could be called an accident. What I considered even more serious was the fact that he had taken the whale boat and the book. What he did to Moby and Dick could have happened to anyone, or almost anyone, and I decided to tell Osk, and later Earth, the truth about the accident. Howard had only meant to help the unfortunate animals. No doubt I would have reacted in just the same way and grabbed hold of the hose. But it was certainly a more unpleasant ordeal having to relate the fate that befell Ahab, which is the iguana. The story of the rodents seemed trivial in comparison. At least these types of animals are easier to replace. I paused for a moment over the word supernatural. Here I am lying under my own bed, recalling the ridiculous death of several animals which my companion and I were paid to look after 5 years ago. And now this Howard, whom I thought had cleared out of my life and was under careful supervision in an institution abroad, is back to haunt me, standing just a partition's width away in the living room. Am I imagining all this? Am I all right? Is something strange going on in my brain, just as I imagined a few hours ago that was the case with Arman Valur? Am I experiencing what I felt earlier today, that I don't really belong here, that this isn't my own home? Is the eccentric up there playing with me? All I need to do is shake my head to get rid of these speculations. Not even that, because as soon as the phone starts ringing in the next room, they disappear. This phone won't leave us in peace, Howard barks. It's all going to end in a mess. That is just what I am beginning to be afraid of too. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brevi, for that reading. Rereading the novel before tonight and hearing you read it just now, I'm reminded by just how many disasters there are in your book and how many things go wrong for the characters. There's a phrase in one of Brevi's novels, Days of Repose, which in a translation by Vera Júlósdóttir reads, quote, "Nothing must go wrong, or I might literally drop dead." And I think that one thing that is true of Brevi's work is this interest in things that can go wrong. So I wondered if you might talk a little about the sort of disasters and how important they are to you as a writer.
Well, I just probably use disasters to start a story. I mean, I need something to start a story, and if everything goes smoothly and nothing is wrong, the story wouldn't be too interesting, I think. Because you're always, like in everyday life, you're always imagining what will go wrong next. At least myself, I'm always expecting something to go wrong, even now at this moment. And you will be leaving in 2 minutes. I can't really explain it any further.
Well, hopefully we'll get through this conversation and no pets will be harmed in the process.
Well, there's one pet in the story that survives.
Yes.
If I remember correctly. Yes.
that sort of sense of something going wrong as something that is necessary to your...